welcome everybody, and good to see you all. 37 participants, that's a good sized school. Luckily, we are three people to assist you as we go along. And this first little set of slides will introduce ourselves with a little background, our various areas of research in the past, and how we kind of divide, let's say, tasks between each other in the team. So I have a few slides on myself, and then Eric will say a few words, and then yes. So I'm born in Copenhagen, Denmark, on the other side of the planet. No point, never mind. In 1973. I did my first neutron scattering experiments at the laser reactor in 1997 in connection with my bachelor thesis on rare earth magnetism. Then I actually moved to X-rays for a while. I worked in the X-ray laboratory at the University of Copenhagen, and I ended up making my my master's in physics and bachelor's in mathematics on quantum wave functions in tomographic reconstruction. For a little while, I worked for the neurobiology research unit at Copenhagen University Hospital. You can say that my deep software work that actually kind of started there in applications for medical doctors for numerical work and visualization of human brain scans. And then actually since 2002, I've been a development engineer on the McStas project. Formally my position is actually the same, but the organization changed quite a bit. So since then, I was employed at the Israel National Lab that was later on merged with the Technical University, and I'm now at the Physics Department of the Technical University. And since 2015, seconded to the European Spallation Source, working at the Data Management and Software Center there for a third of my time. So you can say they own a third of me, and they claim it's this part. So McStas has been funded in the past, mainly from EU projects, and then construction projects such as the ICES Civil Time Station project, and the ESS, and so forth. And my daily task with respect to McStas span everything, basically. So I develop new functionality, both physics and infrastructure-wise, all the way through the layers of the code. I work with the users to solve their problems in any area of neutron scattering. So I talk to people doing reflectometry at spallation source, or people doing power diffraction at a research reactor, or anything you can imagine. So I'm considered the software expert for anything McStas in some sense. But it also means that sometimes I'm the one that has to sweep the floor, right? So it's sometimes very basic what I need to do. And I take pride in teaching users about the code and how to use it in an efficient way. So that is basically the little corner of the world that I work from. Of course, I work all over the world. I work with people from all of the facilities everywhere. My world spins around Copenhagen with some activities in southern Sweden also. So you have the Danish flag over there, which is red and white, and you have the Swedish flag, which is blue and yellow, and then actually Scania, the most southern part of Sweden, used to be Danish, so there's a special flag there, which is a kind of mix, right? You could say that maybe we're taking it back, just a little. Okay, anyway. Over to Eric.
Yeah. All right, Eric. You can see my middle name there. It's kind of I married a Swede, which means that I now have a name that nobody ever in the world can spell. If I'm in Sweden, they can't spell my last name, and if I'm in Denmark, they can't spell my middle name. And if I'm anywhere else, they can't spell anything. So anyway, I was born in Sweden, actually, as you can see from the map. Grew up there. I graduated from Lund University. I took a PhD in fiber optics, so I come from an optics background, really. And then I slowly drifted into X-rays, and from there on, I ended up in neutrons. And actually, then later on, I ended up going back, slightly back to X-rays, because I also take care of the X-ray port of McStas. So there's a version of McStas, we call it called X-rays, that deals with X-rays in mostly the same manner as for McStas. So anything that you should you happen to move into X-rays, so anything you learn at this school could actually more or less be applicable to this. And so just a quick slide on my general responsibilities and research interests. I take care of the polarized subsystem of McStas. So if you end up doing polarized neutron simulations, that's part of that's my business. I'm the main developer now for MagnetSpress, as Peter was the head honcho for McStas. When I did MagnetSpress, that's me. Some of the things that we're looking at right now is interference effects. Some people are talking about this becoming relevant for neutrons as well. And that to do that with ray tracing is can be quite daunting and complicated to get it right. We also do some vector interaction orientation scanning simulations, and also a recent development is that we've been using MagnetSpress to simulate X-ray space telescopes to be launched into space. And also a little side project, we're trying to do something called MagHelium to do ray tracing simulations of helium scattering. It's a very small community, but they don't have a simulation tool, and we do. So, without further ado, that will be over to you, Mas.
So, I'm Mas Patterson, the newest member of the team, a bit younger than the other thing. I have been studying at University of Copenhagen, where I got both my master degree and my PhD. And this has more or less all of it been in neutron instrumentation and simulation. So I'm only here 1st of January, moved to my first position outside of the University of Copenhagen, which is at the European Spallation Shops, the Data Management Center, which is also situated in Copenhagen. And then a bit about what I've been doing in the past. It's the first part of my career, master's I was doing was guide simulations. So I made some mathematical boundary conditions for optimization. And after that, the guidepod software, which actually writes the MagStas file for you when you do guidepod. And then one more recent part of the PhD project has been sort of a little expansion to MagStas, which handles sample physics in a more general manner. And then I've been co-proposer of 5 ESS instruments, and 3 of them are accepted for construction, so that's been very exciting to follow. And I've also been providing a large part of the data used to select the ESS moderator decision through butterfly approach, which was heavily constrained by the objects. Looking forward to working on it.
Yeah. And then finally a few words about the school as such. So as you have probably seen, there's a small website which is called csns2019.magstas.org, and that features a calendar here that, well,
defines how we approximately will proceed, but one important detail here is that we will remain flexible, and it means that we will spend the time on what is needed as we move along. Unfortunately, that's not really very visible. Okay, focus on that too much, but the idea is that also in the spirit of being informal, if you have any question or comment as we move along, please put up your hand, indicate, and we will take your comment in the right context. Secondly, when we start the practicals, we propose that you work together in pairs. Finding this little one character that you misplaced, or it's sometimes easier if there's a second set of eyes. Do you either take turns at the keyboard or you simply work directly in pair? Delays are certainly to be expected. So please don't be frustrated if one of the topics spills over to the next day or something.
So I thought it was actually a fourth point.
I can't remember.
Never mind.
So a couple of questions to the audience here. I understood that a few of you actually did run McStas simulations in the past. So how many of you have experience with McStas? Okay, so you kind of scattered around, that's good. And I know that, that CSNS was VTS land very much in the past. So, who of you have experience with VTS?
With this.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, so it's kind of the same people, basically. So, okay, that's good to know. So, you already know the issues of thinking coordinate system-wise, that they are rotated slightly different, and units of centimeters to meters can sometimes cause frustration, but anyway. Okay, that's good to know. We proceed and we start with an introduction to McStas. So the agenda for this talk is a very brief introduction to neutrons, you all know neutrons, Monte Carlo ray tracing, components of neutron instruments, how McStas works under the hood, and then finally a demo. We are all here because Sir James Chadwick found the neutron in 1992, and you of course know all the different physical properties of it, and this is typically to point out to people that are not in neutron scattering that velocities are in a range where we can manipulate the neutron beam using mechanical devices like shuttles, velocity selectors, and so forth. As you know, our main kinds of neutron facilities these days are either based on fission or oscillation. And I don't know exactly where CSNS would be on this brilliance chart, so it's missing there, I found. But I guess somewhere around between ISIS and SNS or something like that, probably would be my guess.
Yeah.
So as you probably already know, McStas is a Monte Carlo ray tracer. And in the big picture, it's actually nothing but this. Particles being, so you set up an instrument which is defining your lab space, so to speak. Within that, you put components representing your source, different pieces of optics, sample, and then monitors. And in that, you transport neutrons. and they are simply emitted at the source with randomized starting conditions by Monte Carlo, traced through space, deterministically whenever we can. Once complexity of a given object on the beam line is complex enough, we may have to use Monte Carlo again. So this would be in a powder, for instance. You will have the possibility to scatter off of multiple red lines. We find which one of them, and we also cast a random number to decide where it goes on the bi-shadow coding and so forth. And as we move through the instrument, we can measure the state of the neutron, and this happens in a monitor. But in fact, the right name for that is probably a probe. So we magically read out whatever the neutron state is. There's actually not any physics going on in this readout, typically. So as we will come back to, we do have models that also introduce physics for the monitors, but generally speaking, yeah, you can consider them perfect. So just a rule of thumb for Monte Carlo. Why on earth are we using this? Well, the idea is that once complexity of a mathematical problem is too large to solve using analytical methods, Monte Carlo is a good approach. So a rule of thumb is that the dimensionality of the phase space should at least exceed 5 orders. And then a requirement is that each of, in this transport of events, that each of these events can be computed easily and independently. So you can think of it as a kind of sledgehammer approach. It's a lazy guy method. So historical examples of the application of Monte Carlo techniques. The first ever was not actually called Monte Carlo. It was a kind of numerical experiment by Comte Buffon in France that threw needles on a floor that was lined, and that actually gave the possibility of estimating pi. Right? Here's another visualization of the estimate of pi. You throw random positions in x and y, you color them red under the unit circle, you color them green outside, and of course the sum of all of this over what is only red will give you an estimate of pi, which will converge better and better as you cast more random numbers. And of course Monte Carlo was used in many different disciplines like molecular dynamics or spin system phase transitions or nuclear reactions or ray tracing, as we do here. Of course, to implement Monte Carlo methods, we need random number generators. So if this was to be really random, a good solution would be some kind of quantum device. Something that, a box with a gas, and something like that. So what we do instead, which is actually also an advantage in some sense, because it isn't really random, that is the introduction of pseudo-random numbers out of computers. So numbers that look as if they are random, but are really a very complicated sequence of numbers bouncing back and forth between 0 and 1. So you can think of these typically as a probability. A very important feature in the use of McStas is importance sampling, and we'll come back to this again and again. So an expensive way of doing Monte Carlo would be that we transport every neutron out of the source, and this means also the ones that are absorbed. And of course, a lot of these will be absorbed in the beginning of our guide system. And that is statistically not very efficient. So instead we introduce what we call OME, which is an intensity which is then reduced according to the probabilities of the physics that happen. So a neutron event is produced at the source. It impinges on the first mirror that has 99% maybe probability of reflection, and this means that we scale down by 0.99. The same would be the case if reflectivity was 70%. we scale down by 0.7. Okay, that's the way. And then we continue our way. Good. Yeah, so the origin of Monte Carlo methods as we know them today is essentially the Maxim project. So the first code as such a mathematical algorithm that was formulated rigorously was by von Neumann and Ulam and Patella. And actually the name, of course, Monte Carlo kind of indicates a lottery or a game. And it certainly is, but it's not the Monte Carlo of Southern Europe. It's actually a specific casino in Las Vegas, where Ulam's father went to play poker. The first devices to run this kind of probe or algorithm were the Fermiac. Actually, I never saw it physically, and I didn't really read up on the properties of it, but it's a mechanical device. It has some conical gears, it's very special, and it's of course the Italian navigator that created this device, and it was used for the study of the movement of neutrons in the fission of the atomic bomb. And that's a physical device. You can go and look at it at the museum in Los Alamos, I believe. The first digital computer that this came out was the ENIAC. That was actually intended for ballistic research, so a US Army laboratory. But it was found that this kind of code would actually run quite efficient on that. So it was coded up using cards, etc. It was used in the days of, if not the first fission bomb, then at least the fusion bomb, right, for the hydrogen bomb. Later on, this machine was moved to University of Pennsylvania, which actually has a bit of it left still, which is on display. So since then, Los Alamos and the other US labs have perfected Monte Carlo, of course still focusing mainly on their areas of business, which is bombs and power reactors and high energies, essentially, or let's say multi-scale physics. And originally, MCMP, the meaning of that was Monte Carlo neutron photon. These days it's rather N particle, so they transport almost anything you can imagine from the standard model. Also complicated things like nuclei of lead that you collide in CERN, for instance, to look at the whole standard model particle soon. But as the focus is on high energies, the kind of properties that we're typically interested in, which is structure and dynamics of matter on the atomic scale, is not too relevant for them. So most of their material models are in fact gases. They have no concept of coherence gathering and crystalline materials. And this is then where we come in. So that's basically our niche. We'll come back to this. So In this sense, in McStas, the source is never, let's say, the photon beam of the accelerator or the fission process of the reactor. It's actually the output of the moderators of the given facility. So different examples of Monte Carlo ray tracers. This approach is used in light ray tracing, like power ray for rendering visual scene of this room, maybe. Of course, also for the nuclear reactor simulations or multi-scale physics there, with less of a concept of coherence gathering, of course. Then codes like McStas and VTS and RESTREX, and there are three American codes as well. The first of the type, which is called NISP, the neutron instrument simulation program that actually has some of the counter-engine which is derived from an early version of NBI KU. Ideas that came with the SNS project, but to my knowledge is abandoned. And then there's McVine, which is by Xiaolin. I don't know if you know Xiaolin, who's
Intel.
Yeah, so he's working in Overage. He worked with Brent Fools at Caltech, I think you call that. And to be fair, that's of course it has other components, but it also actually has a lot of McStas in there. So it's kind of built on McStas. And in all these cases, neutrons are described with a position in space, a velocity vector, a polarization at a time, and transported along its movements. And propagation is simply according to classical mechanics, rules of neutron, including gravitation and so forth. In X-rays, we have like X-rays, and we have other groups like shadow from ESIF, and ray from PSI, and yeah, then the specialized things for your equivalent sources like
what's it called?
SRW. It's not exactly, well, it's not exactly ray tracing, it's more of a phase space waveform propagation. Right. So we do ray tracing in McStas. We don't do it in the same direction as you would render a scene of this room, say. This you would typically do from, let's say, the observer, from the detector, the eye, and then you would move back to the source. Because a lot of absorption imperfections happen. So the statistically most efficient way would actually be to do it from the detector and back to the source. This is, on the other hand, also more complex. And for this reason, we do it from the source to the detector. And whenever neutrons move in free space, of course, we can let them move in parallel. That's why it's switching on gravitation. So together, the solution of using Monte Carlo together with deterministic propagation makes both a realistic and an efficient transport of neutrons, where we actually, depending on where we are in the simulation process, we move between a particle picture, which is typically between in the free space between the objects, and a wave picture. So if we are in a sample, for instance, and we know this is a power sample, we are more in the, let's say, in the wave picture of a textbook on solid state materials. Yeah. So we describe neutron instruments, and as I already mentioned, in McStas the source is actually the monitor. It's the output of the monitor. We have models of neutron objects that include things like mirrors and guides, collimators and slits, disk choppers, fermion choppers, velocity selectors, crystal monitors, and so forth. You can introduce a sample, and we have access to models that are single crystalline, powders, liquids, micelles of different kinds, whatever you put on your sense machine. You can do some neutron imaging. You may have inelastic features like phonons or spin waves or things. And then finally we have detectors, and as I also mentioned before, they mostly work like perfect probes, and they can be positioned more or less throughout the instrument, allowing you to visualize properties of the beam in one or two dimensional plots, or in this situation. As you can already see, McStas is a quite flexible and general utility for neutron scattering instruments and experiments. The name is actually from originally being designed to do Monte Carlo simulation of triple axis spectrometers. That's the TAS. So the TAS in McStas, that is a proper TAS. But if we count the models we have available today, the right name would actually be McStas. But I think that sounds a bit strange. So we keep McStas. We really have a lot of time fighting students today. It's a common effort of DTU Physics, where Eric and myself are based. ILL in Grenoble, PSI in Switzerland, University of Copenhagen, and ESS DNSC by Matt Berthelsen and a third of myself. The first version came out in 1998. It was a collaboration between a computer scientist called Christian Nielsen, and luckily so, because his design from back then is basically what the rest of us have relied on ever since. And we tried hard, but we never made it really a physicist's spaghetti code. It's still according to his good design from the past. And he worked with Kim Neffen, who is still associated with McStas as well. These days he's more of a super user than actually a developer. And if he develops something, it's typically in the range of sample kernels and these kinds of things. So for his specific research. And a small anecdote here, we will come back to the specifics of the McStas language. But the way it was established was actually a group of physicists at the Laser National Lab that proposed with the question of if there was a code that worked like this, that had models of the different parts of the instrument, what would the syntax look like? And then they would write that on a piece of paper. And Christian Nielsen actually took that information and more or less the grammar of the McStas language came from that. And this, I think, is quite nice. And this is also why the look and feel of the code and the concept is quite close to what you will find if you think of a reactor instrument, for instance. You will have rotating objects and so forth, and the whole concept and the way of thinking is actually quite close. But as you can see, we're a relatively small group of people, so the bulk of the development team is actually in the room. It's an open source code, there's a part of the website, there's a user mailing list, and you should enroll yourself on that, for sure. There's my age page, which is about the same. A younger sibling, so McStas had a 20-year anniversary last year, and McStas, also my age page, actually has a 10-year anniversary this year. But the concepts are very much the same. It's used in many places. So just a kind of commercial break here. Typically, McStas is not used on its own. So there's also Vitess that supplements it, or Restrex, or another code. Or you do analytical estimates, back of the envelope calculations, and so forth. Because you shouldn't trust it blindly, that's for sure. We do our best. There are bugs, there are inconsistencies, that's how it is. So you better have a sanity check. That's an important message. But it's been successfully applied in all the bigger instrumentation projects for the last 2 decades. So what's it used for? Well, obviously you can build models of your neutron instruments, three-dimensional models, and study correlations between the parameters of the beam as you move through the instrument. So for planning and constructing instruments, then if you add matter in the sample position, you are allowed to do virtual experiments that will have many of the features of what you can measure at your instrument, your physical instrument. This in turn allows you to do phase analysis if you like. So if you have a beam at the sample position, of course virtual neutrons are nice in the way that you can study parameters that are not directly accessible on the experiment. So you may decompose what you measure at the detector into what was contributions of coherent and incoherent scattering, or spurious contributions or imperfections from the sample environment. So these kinds of effects are now accessible. We also use it for teaching purposes. So at University of Copenhagen and DTU, we have courses where the students are lectured theory of neutron scattering. They build the instrument models with McStas and they perform virtual experiments. And they may eventually also go to a facility and do an experiment. And Kim Lefman always claims that once he has lectured some McStas to the students and they've used it for a while, they behave as if they had already been traveling back and forth to experiments once they go to PSI. They are already familiar with this. So in terms of reliability, again, I say we do our best. Once in a while we do find bugs, but we spend quite a lot of time comparing with the other codes, and essentially they agree. More importantly, when you compare with experiments, experimental line shapes and things like that, features of the beam, divergences, widths, and so forth, are very quickly reproduced to within a few percent. Absolute intensities may be slightly different, especially if you have a legacy source. So if all you have is a curve on a piece of paper that characterizes your moderators from 1970, where your reactor was erected, maybe these blueprints are not actually what they are physically. There was a long-standing factor of 3, for instance, in case of some of the ISIS moderators. And this was due to the presence of some boron in the vicinity of a moderator that was actually not in blueprints. That's difficult to do. This is easier when you know when you have a known source and you have a better model of what is in there. But the common understanding is that McStas and all the similar codes are quite reliable. It's a portable code that runs on any kind of operating system. It did run on an iPhone once that I had just to try. Not very fast or anything, but it runs. It has the different component files. It says 100 here. I think we have 150 or so. There are sources and optics and samples and monitors. And if necessary, you can write your own components. And then we rely on what is called a DSL, a domain-specific language, and a code generation technique. So it means that you write your simple McStas instrument file. That essentially, I wouldn't say it's English, but it's kind of close. You place objects and different parameters and location. You refer to other components and so forth, and this way you build a model of the instrument. And from this, we do a pre-compilation, if you like. We run the McStas executable, which is a code generator that will then write one piece of C code that you give to the compiler. And this is, of course, all done transparently. So you have a user interface, you work on the instrument file there, and this is then automatically transferred to an executable in the background. If there are errors, you will have errors, and this means you can have errors from the code generation layer, but also, let's say, the C compilation, if there's a bug in a certain C code, you may have an actual compilation error instead. So the component codes realize the different beam parts. We have libraries for different functionality like reading and writing files, random numbers, physical constants, propagation, position in fields, and so forth. So this is centralized in libraries, but typically it actually came from a component. So the real layer of growth in McStas is the components. But once something is useful, in more than one component, we try to bring it out into a library. So, as you can imagine, there are three levels of source code involved here. An instrument file, which is what you have to manipulate and write to run with this. A component file that you may want to write yourself. And then a C code that is essentially for the compiler. It's not so pretty to look at, but it works. So, just a quick example here. I think we're actually more or less ahead here. component file, lots of comments, some sections that actually implement the physics. We will come back to the details of this as we move along. And then not so nice to look at the C code with lots of defines. So as a result, McStas is a pre-compiler. The input is component and instrument files, runtime functions for random numbers, etc. And the output is one single C file, which can then be compiled with the GCC. And you can take it takes input parameters if you define. So looking at our, well, I said 150, that's not true, we have 200. So if you look at the logarithm of the number of lines of code in the typical McStas components, you see we have a plateau around 1-200 lines of code. So that's the typical McStas component. So this means, don't be shy. I mean, if you are in doubt if something works right, just open it up, it's 200 lines of code. Most problems can be solved that way. And the outliers that are 10,000 lines, they should have not been done this way. That's for sure. So I would say that the isotropic S2 omega there, that's one of the more complex ones. That's probably the level. If you're using 10,000 lines of code, there might be a better way to do it. And the good thing about this is that it allows the instrument scientist to write a small code. Not as in the old days, write a full code for his own instrument. He actually relies on work that others did. And this means there's a chance that people like yourselves can contribute back to McStas this way. And that's an important detail here, that actually up to around 40% of these 200 components were contributed from people like yourselves, so not written by us. So I would say we have no formal refereeing of the code other than having a look if it looks reasonable. The main requirement is that there's a test instrument, so if there's a new component, there should be a reliable setting of it that explains you what to do with it and gives reasonable output. So a test instrument and then meaningful documentation. And this is something you write directly in the code. And contributions go to a dedicated section of the library. So you always know if something is written by us or if it's written by a contributor from the outside. It doesn't mean that we don't take responsibility. Of course we do. We help users no matter what kind of code it is, but we may then rely on the person that contributed the code. So from the example suite, all kinds of different graphics here. Small magnet scattering, power diffraction, single crystal diffraction, strange kind of imaging there, a nicer type of imaging up here. Anything you can imagine is actually in there. And that's an important point. If you are in doubt about, once you work yourself with the code, if you are in doubt about how some of these components work, have a look if there's not an example in the existing instruments. There's a good chance for this. And that's not at all the end, it's just the beginning. And I give the word to Mass, who will do a small online demonstration for you.